and a privilege, an honour indeed, to be here. Thanks very much for inviting me. And it's great to be sitting on a platform again with Elaine. Just want to start by quoting you from the document that was approved by the 7th Communist Party Congress at Cuba just last month. Because people, some people on the left, and I was at a meeting recently, where there was considerable concern that Cuba was not socialist anymore. And I think some of the people that say that are grinding a political axe of their own. But there is concern that Cuba's trajectory is of, you know, the slippery slope or the thin edge of the wedge idea, that it's on some kind of road towards capitalism, like, you know. And I think certainly, and I'll go on and talk a little bit about American policy in a moment, but American policy is predicated upon that idea that by changing their let's say attitude or approach to Cuba rather than, let's say, policy at the moment, they might be able to speed up what they think is a transition in Cuba towards a capitalist economy. If that's the case, then the Cuban Communist Party doesn't realise it. I'll just quote to you the first paragraph of the aims and objectives that were agreed at the Communist Party Congress under the heading, number one, a sustainable and prosperous socialist society. Our socialist society, which is in the process of formation, is profoundly humanist and democratic. It's oriented to overcome definitively the capitalist system, whose propulsive force is self-interest and consumerism, and in which the social production is realized at the expense of a growing process of alienation and social differentiation that converts people into instruments at the service of capital and provoking their dehumanization. Our final strategic goal is the development, the integral development of the human being with elevated values and ethical principles, being indispensable to the consolidation progressively of a socialist system. So, any idea that Cuba is embarked upon a gradual change towards capitalism is mistaken. What is happening in Cuba is a process of economic change that is aimed at developing the productive capacity of the country. And it's chosen to adopt certain market mechanisms to do so. Political fabric of Cuba is not going to change. So we have in the world already two successful models, political and economic models of this in China and Vietnam. So what is happening in Cuba is the development of a model, not a copy, but an adaptation, if you like, an innovation based upon the Cuban characteristics of an economic and political model that has been successful in generating growth in productivity in China and Vietnam. And the application of those principles is taking place in Cuba with the aim of not producing a transformation to capitalism in Cuba, but to the development of a new socialist model based upon Cuban characteristics. And so it's a big challenge. I was at a meeting recently where I was in New York actually for the Latin American Studies Association conference, which is the academics, the American Academic Association of Latin American Scholars, and Cuba is very much a part of it. And there were 250 Cuban academics there. It's a massive conference. There's about 5,000 delegates there in a big hotel in New York for 3 days. But one of the Cubans was saying that this process that Cuba's embarked upon has never been tried before. Yes, the Chinese have done something. Yes, the Vietnamese have done something. But neither of them, in the conditions that they're in, from their point of view, where they're located geographically, their economies, the way their economies are constructed, the way in which they, that their developmental process historically, etc., etc., etc. No other country has been in the conditions that Cuba is in and tried this. So what Cuba is doing is actually inventing something new. So it's a very challenging time, not just for Cuba, but for everybody who supports Cuba, because Cuba needs still the support of socialists around the world for what it's trying to do. It's trying to develop an alternative model. It's trying to develop a process of economic transformation that will liberate market forces, but put the market forces in the service of developing a socialist and a democratic system. And that needs people to engage with it and to empathise with it and to assist it. So it requires us to step up our game in understanding it and debating it and developing it. Now, all this has got to take place under very difficult conditions because, of course, the American response to it is to switch from one of outright open hostility to one of, let's say, as Gerardo said, I think, you know, they're trying to kill us with a bear hug now. I mean, how to best explain American policy? I don't know if you know this, but people, probably all of you do know this, that in the 19th century, the American policy became known as the ripe fruit policy after a speech that was made by John Quincy Adams, the Secretary of State, in 1822, in which he said that, you know, Cuba was like a ripe fruit on the tree waiting to fall into the United States' hands once it's is severed by its unnatural adherence to the tree of Spain. It will fall like an apple falls to gravity into our lap. So all we have to do is wait for Cuba to become ours. So that was known as the ripe fruit policy. Well, today the metaphor has been adapted and changed, and it's now the poisoned apple policy. Rather like, you know, Snow White, the evil witch has disguised itself, and the wicked queen, I should say, has disguised herself and is now knocking on the door, offering Cuba a very ripe fruit to bite upon. And so Cuba has to be very, very careful not to allow itself to be seduced by this embrace that has come from the United States. Well, I mean, as was pointed out very clearly at the Communist Party Congress and subsequently only last week CARICOM summit by President Castro, the United States policy is not really changed. Last week, in the context of the CARICOM summit, Cuba reaffirmed its support of Venezuela and the Maduro government in Venezuela. and placed itself firmly on against, and they used the term, American imperialism. They said, Cuba will never rejoin the Organization of American States. The Organization of American States was, is, and shall always be a tool of American imperialism. The Cubans haven't changed their language. They're still talking in the same language they always talked. And that is really important to hang on to. No matter how much the American rhetoric changes, no matter how much the Americans alter their policy towards Cuba, Cuba's situation and Cuba's position is one of still being subject to American imperialism, and they know it. So what the Americans are doing is changing, really, their tactics. They're not actually changing their overall goal or strategy, which is to bring about the downfall of socialism in Cuba. But the Cubans are in the position of facing a United States that is in its own process of transforming itself on the global sphere. What lies behind the American change in policy is, in fact, a decline in American power. The picture for Cuba and for socialism globally really is quite optimistic, because capitalism is in trouble, and the banking crisis of 2008 is only another one of a series that are going to happen. Fundamentally, if we learned anything from the last decade, is that Marx at least was right about one thing, that capitalism will always lead to these crises. And these crises are, in the end, insoluble. And the next one is around the corner. We all know it is, because George Osborne told us it is. They know it too. So the situation is that basically some form of global governance is inevitable in the longer term, and the Americans are beginning to realise that. This period after the end of the Cold War, when the United States felt it could do what it liked, this unilateral global hegemon, as it thought itself to be, has petered out. It's petered out because of the failures militarily in Afghanistan and Iraq, the catastrophes that were produced there, and because of the banking crisis, and because China has grown in power and economic importance, and very soon will be number one economic power in the world. I mean, it's only a matter of probably 5 years, no more than 10, when China will overtake the United States in terms of GDP. And it's already the world's number one trading power. I mean, in terms of exports and imports. And China's role in the world is ipso facto fundamentally different from that which we have ever known from a hegemonic power before. And that is that it will be the first time in history that the number one economic power in the world will be a developing country. China is still a developing country. And China is a country which suffered from imperialism. And whether you are of the opinion that China really isn't a socialist country, because of its economic system at the moment, whether or not you think it, rhetorically it is. And its way of behaving in the world is fundamentally different from that, the way in which Western liberal capitalist democracies have operated in the world. Its form of imperialism, if you want to call it imperialism, is less, is more benign, let's say, is less exploitative, is more inclined towards mutual development processes rather than exploitation. True enough, China wants resources, but its way of dealing with other countries is far more respectful of their sovereignty, is far more respectful of their interests than Western imperialism, which is why it's such a big challenge to the Western liberal democratic order. And it's one in which the United States knows it cannot defeat. And therefore, the United States is having to accommodate itself to living once again in a world in which it cannot dictate all the terms anymore. And part of the problem that it has, therefore, is reconfiguring itself. Obama is very, very rapidly trying in the last year of his presidency to put in place a structure or a reconfiguration of American foreign policy in the hope that Hillary will win and she can continue it. Or if the nightmare happens and Trump wins, he won't be able to alter it too much. Cuba is a part of that. And that's really what's driving this. It's not really the United States has suddenly decided that it wants to be nice to Cuba. No, it's got its own interests that it is pursuing, and Cuba is a part of it. Now, where does it leave us? Well, the United States has said it wants to normalize relations. If you talk to a Cuban about that, the Cubans say, well, what's normal, you know? Normal is you telling us what to do, you know? Normal is, you know, the way you've behaved towards Cuba for the last 200 years. That's what normal is. What you're doing is abnormalizing the relationship. If you want to be friends with us, if you want to respect our sovereignty, that's abnormalizing the relations. That's doing something completely different. That's something that we're not used to doing, right? So the Cubans have got a very kind of a cynical, like this is a poisoned apple, the leopard don't change its spots, we've got to be very, very careful. And the Cubans have also got this, well, we didn't get this by giving in. We got this by saying no. We said no for 50 years, and they finally came around to our way of thinking. So why should we change our policy now? We're not going to give anything away. We're not going to give anything away. And actually, they haven't. They haven't done anything. And of course, what the right-wing in the United States are screaming at is, Obama's done this without getting any concessions from the Cubans. Look, he's done all this and he hasn't got one concession from them. The only thing they've done is invite him to give a speech in Havana. But the rest of it, no. They haven't done anything. And of course, that's true. The Cubans really have been very, very firm. They've said, we want to deal with you as equals. We are going to do this as a process of negotiation, and they are in a process of discussions. And you will notice that the embargo is still there. All right, they've opened what they call an embassy, but they still haven't got an ambassador. Why? Because the Congress won't approve the ambassador. He is an ambassador, but he's not called an ambassador because the Senate or the Congress won't give him the title. So Obama has come to the banks. Obama has given the banks authorization, American banks, the authorization to allow Americans to use credit cards in Cuba when they travel there. Allowed for Cubans to open bank accounts in American banks. And the banks in America haven't done it. Obama, the President of the United States, has authorized the banks to do this, and the banks won't do it. And the President has told the banks to do it, and the banks won't do it. And when they said, well, why won't the banks do it? Because they're private institutions and they can do what they like, okay? And when the banks have been asked, well, why won't we do it? They said, well, you know, there's a risk involved because they might change their minds. We don't know what's going to happen. And it costs a lot of money to reconfigure all our software so that, you know, it's okay to trade with Cuba. And if we change all our software just for the Cuban market, it's not really big enough, it's not worth it. So the banks, the American banks, haven't changed the way they operate. So that's kind of frozen, not because of the Cubans, but because of the inertia in the United States. Obama has made changes where he can, and they have produced some dramatic effects. The biggest effect has been in the number of visitors to Cuba. I was there in February, and it was full. I mean, it was full. Every hotel room that had water that lose the flush were occupied. You couldn't get into Havana because there were so many American visitors. And that's not that tourism is allowed. The president can't, according to US law, can't authorize for Americans to visit Cuba as tourists. What he can do is allow them to visit for specific reasons, and there are 12 categories. And essentially, the president is charged with administering the legally permitted visits to Cuba, and these include things like humanitarian exchanges between religious, social groups, charities, organizations of various kinds, visits by academics or students for the purposes of education, visits by business people for the purposes of doing business. Even though they can't still technically do much business, they can visit with the view to doing business when they are permitted to do so in the future. So business visits are authorized, journalistic visits are authorized. And so within those categories, licenses can be issued for traveling. And basically what Obama has done is allow anybody to get a license for basically doing nothing. I mean, simply going to an approved travel agent and buying a ticket is sufficient to get a license now. So essentially, you can go to Cuba whenever you like. And this week, just yesterday in fact, they finally got, the Department of Transportation finally approved 6 airlines who will be able now to provide commercial flights to Cuba. At the moment, all the flights, there are a lot of flights. I've lost count how many there are, but there are at least 25 charter flights a day from Miami alone. There's a lot of flights to Cuba, but they're all charters. But now the commercial airlines will be flying, and they'll be flying from 16 different cities across the United States to all of the major cities in Cuba. So places like Matanzas, Camagüey, you know, all of the cities in Cuba that have an international airport will be receiving flights from the United States. And there'll be commercial flights, so you'll be able to book online and pay for online. And you'll be able to just go. And that will mean that over the next 2 to 3 years, there will be increasing pressure in the United States from tourism-related industries for the right to operate in Cuba. Now, Obama has authorized two hotel chains to operate hotels in Cuba, and there are a number of hotels being built now, new hotels being built, which are going to be operated by American companies like Marriott. I think the company's called Starwood Hotels. And so they're the first two American companies that really have been given permission to operate in Cuba. Now that process, certainly if Hillary wins, will continue. So what you're going to have is a gradual sort of process of denudation of the embargo. I think pretty soon there will be authorization for Cuba to sell medical products in the United States market. There are two products that are really being pushed for by very serious senior people, both politically and in the business world, that the Cubans make that nobody else makes. One is a very, very effective treatment for diabetic ulcers. The only treatment that there is in the United States and indeed in Britain for a diabetic ulceration is amputation. And it involves serial amputation. You know, you get an ulcer at the end of your extremity, then you cut one bit off, and then you get it again and you cut another bit off, and so on. So you have to have serial amputations. Of course, there's a big cost in surgery, a massive amount of risk of infection and so on, and dealing with that. And in the United States at the moment, there are something like 120,000 operations a year carried out at great cost. But the Cuban treatment is called Heberprop B. It's a topical ointment cream application that they put on the ulcer, and it, in 80%, more than 80% of the cases, it cures it, stops it, so you don't need to amputate the limb. So the cost saving in terms of treatment is enormous, and there's a company backed by very senior Democrat politicians that wishes to market this product in the United States. And I think that's very likely to be approved, probably before Obama leaves office. And then more recently, there's been a lot of, and you always have to watch, if you Google Cuba news and you read the news feed from Google, you see the headlines, you see where things are going, because there is a kind of a media propaganda war going on, you know. And the stories that make the headlines are the ones they want you to read, you know. And recently there's been a number of stories appearing about this product called Cimavax. Now Cimavax is, there are five of these. There are cancer, what are called cancer vaccines. And Cuba has developed these. This is all Cuban science, which is one of its great achievements. There are five vaccines that they use for terminal cancer. Now, it's not a prevention of the illness. It's a prevention or they stimulate the body's immune system to attack cancer cells. And these products are used on people who've had, you know, the last bout of chemotherapy they could possibly have, who've got a terminal cancer that, you know, they are waiting to die. So they are given these vaccines, and it prolongs the length of time that they live. So the average length of time that a Cuban terminal cancer patient lives now is 2 years, whereas in the United States it's about 6 months. And very recently there's been this human interest story, and I think it's on the wires right now, so you could read it yourselves later on if you Google it. There's one guy, an American, who suddenly made big headlines because he's lived 5 years with lung cancer, terminal lung cancer. And he's done it by travelling to Cuba for the last 5 years via Canada, because he wasn't able to do so secretly, and buying these drugs in Cuba and injecting himself when he got home, in cahoots with his oncologist, who has kept the secret. And now they're coming out because this oncologist says the Cuban vaccine works. My patient wouldn't be alive if he didn't have this vaccine. And he's one of the longest living survivors. And every doctor said that he would have lived only 2 months with the cancer he's got, and he's lived 5 years. So he's one of the longest living patients. Now, the fact is that these drugs, once people know that they exist, they're going to want them, they're going to demand them. So there's going to be, along with a lot of people saying, I want to invest in Cuban tourism. Why the hell are these European, why the hell are these Americans going to Cuba and staying in hotels that are being run by Spanish companies? And Canadian companies, for God's sake. Why the hell can't we have some of that business? Why can't we invest in Cuban tourism? We want to invest in Cuban tourism, but hell, you know, the American tourists, they're already saying, American tourists are going to Havana, they're staying in a hotel which is run by a Spanish company, they're hiring cars that are made by a Korean company, they're eating food that was imported from Mexico, they're drinking drinks that were made, you know, elsewhere. Why the hell can't we have some of that business? So there's that big demand developing. You know, why should American dollars being spent in Cuba go to our competitors? And the same thing is happening. Hell, if these Cubans are living 2 years, why the hell can't we live 2 years? You know, we need these drugs. You know, so there's going to be this demand placed upon the politicians to do something. And they will. It's a deliberate policy to engender the demand so that they can respond to it and carry it out. Because the forces that are at work within the Congress to prevent any change in the law which is required to lift the embargo is not going to happen. The way the embargo has got to come down is through a piecemeal process. And that process will take place in the United States, and it will take place in the United States, and it will not be in response to anything the Cubans do. Because the process is one which has to take place, again, it is seen in America's interest, in the United States' interest, to change its policy towards Cuba, for reasons that have got nothing to do with Cuba, but to do with their global position in the world. So my prediction is that the embargo will come down, but it will come down very slowly, and it probably will come down, I would suggest, at the risk of being disproved, and you know, I'm going on record here, but even if Donald Trump wins the presidency, I think it will probably come down, and it may even come down even quicker if he is president than if Hillary is president. And for all those same reasons that, you know, Trump cannot be accused of being soft on communism, whereas Hillary might be accused of being soft on communism. But the fact is that my prediction is that Hillary will win. I don't know whether anybody in this room would disagree with me. I can't see Donald Trump winning. as much as I kind of don't want to, you know, hedge my bets or anything like that, but I just can't see Donald Trump being able to win enough votes unless Hillary trips up or they find some bigger skeleton in her closet. They've dug out every skeleton she's got, I think, and thrown it at her already. I don't think they can find anything else. I don't think the American people will choose Donald Trump over her. But anyway, she will continue the policy that Obama set in train, not just towards Cuba, but towards Iran, the Middle East, or this whole reconfiguration of American policy which is going on. She will continue. Now, let's just say one or two things about what's going on in Cuba. Cuba's just announced the legalization of private property, private production, so that small and medium-sized private enterprises can exist and have the same rights as cooperative enterprises and so forth, and self-employed. So in other words, it will now be possible for small businesses to operate, and that does present a challenge to a lot of people on the left who adhere to this very strict Marxist-Leninist view that, you know, man's exploitation by man, surplus extraction of surplus labour and so forth. It does mean that there will be small enterprises in Cuba which will be owned by individuals who will be employing others to work for them and therefore will be extracting their surplus labour. And that is, you know, that is a big challenge, but it's one which is in keeping with the process that has been put in train. It is the case that small and medium-sized enterprises are very efficient. They do engender productivity. And when they are competing in a controlled market system, they do develop the economy very quickly. They need to exist in a legal framework. They can't exist in an illegal framework. Well, unfortunately, they already do. It's a bit like, you know, that horse is already gone. There's lots of small and medium-sized enterprises in Cuba, and they are producing large quantities of goods and services which people are consuming, but none of them have got any legal basis. So the legal framework has to be put in place. It's already there. A recent study was done of shoe production. If you ever go to Cuba, you know that there are markets where you can buy lots of goods that are made by small... Well, they're supposed to be made by self-employed people who work on their own. But in fact, there's a whole massive network of little factories in Cuba, small production facilities where lots of people are working away and they are not, strictly speaking, self-employed. I mean, they are, strictly speaking, self-employed, but they're working for some guy or some woman, I don't want to be sexist, somebody who owns the enterprise, who is the kind of person that is taking those goods to market, is organising the production and the marketing of those products. And shoes is a very good example. There's been a very good study done by Cuban academics of the shoe manufacturing business in Cuba, and it is massive. There are small factories all over Cuba operating, making shoes by hand, but in little production processes, and lots and lots of people employed doing it. And basically all the shoes that are being worn by the average Cuban are being made in Cuba, but they are being made in workshops that are, strictly speaking, illegals. So they have to be legalised. There's no way you can shut them down or close them down. They've got to be legalised. And that production process has to be regulated. There has to be safety standards put in place. There's got to be rights for the workers. There's got to be a whole system of, not administration, but regulation of that process. And so when Cuba announced it's going to allow small and medium-sized enterprises to exist, what it's saying is we're going to organise and regulate these production processes. Now, it means that, of course, all of these industries, processes, productions of goods and services, for consumption in the local market and for consumption by state-owned enterprises, because, for example, if I run a hotel, I can now hire people to come in and work for me, maybe cleaners, who are self-employed. I don't have to employ those cleaners anymore. I can employ people from outside who are self-employed to come in and clean. I can buy my furnishings from a local manufacturer. I can buy my food from a local producer. And these local producers are part of the private, what is known as the non-state sector, or the private sector in Cuba. And therefore, this economic transformation is about doing two things. It's about reducing the burden on the state for paying salaries, and increasing people's productivity because they have an incentive to work, because they will be able to keep a greater portion of that which they can earn from doing what they do. And that is really the key. It's about engendering productivity and reducing the burden on the state for the salaries of people. Because what's been happening, of course, in the past, and what developed since the collapse of the Soviet Union, was this kind of Alice in Wonderland type economy, which really wasn't making any sense, because people were being paid state salaries for virtually doing nothing, because their enterprises weren't really operating, but they weren't laid off, they were kept on the payroll, and then they were going off and doing things illegally off the books in the black market in order to make ends meet. Well, you know, so basically the state was paying a salary to people then who were then stealing from the state in order to make ends meet. It's just absolutely crazy and almost incredible how the whole thing worked. So now, basically, people are being laid off from the state employment and being told to go and do what it was they were doing before illegally, legally, being registered as self-employed and paying taxes, and thereby the state wins both ways. The state no longer pays their salaries, but is also collecting revenue from what they're doing. Now, with that revenue, the state will then direct that income to those who are still working in the state sector and doing all those necessary things, nurses, teachers, doctors, all of the social welfare system which Cuba has developed needs to be sustained. And it can't be sustained unless the state increases its revenue, and it has to increase its revenue from developing a viable economy. And that's what it's about. In actual fact, rather than see the development, I'm going to be kind of controversial here, I know, but rather than see the development of this market system in Cuba as being retrograde step, it should be seen as a progressive step in this sense, that if it works, then what will happen is the state will have more money to distribute. In other words, the people that have lost out most are the ones that work for the state and have no income in hard currency. If people who earn hard currency are taxed, the state gets those taxes, they will be able to increase the level of remuneration to those who have missed out. Therefore, the inequalities in society will go down, not up. People are very concerned about the increase in inequality in Cuba as a consequence of these reforms. In actual fact, if the reforms work and the government keeps its policies as they are, then the intention is that actually incomes will equalise, the inequalities will decrease, because the people who are earning the most will pay more taxes, and those who are earning least will have an increase in salaries. And that is very progressive. And I think that's what will happen. Now, why am I so optimistic about that? Well, the key to it is that the government is committed to getting rid of this dual economy. At the moment, there is a differential because the people who work still in the state sector, and that is basically the public services, they're still paid in salaries that are in the national peso, which, if you, as you know, if you've been to Cuba, is worth 1/25 of the convertible peso. And the people that work in the tourist sector and the people who are fortunate enough to have family that live in the exterior, who send them money, and the people who work in the black, well, unofficial market, and the people who in other ways have access to hard currency, they're much better off because they're earning money in this hard currency, which is worth 25 times that which the person who works in the state gets. Now, in order to raise the state's got to raise the wages of the people who work in the state sector before it can get rid of this dual currency. Now, the only way that can happen is if they get themselves in a position where they can tax and recuperate money from the hard currency sector in sufficient quantities. And when they can do that, then they'll be able to equalise the currencies. And when they equalise the currencies, it will mean that people will be able to be rewarded properly. At the moment, the Cubans have got this principle that they've moved from this principle of egalitarianism towards the socialist stage, which is to each according to his work or her work. Well, that can't actually work if you've got two currencies, one which is so much worth so much less than the other. You can't reward people according to their work if one person's work is paid in one currency which is worth 25 times what another person's work is in the other currency. So you've got to equalise the currency in order to make sense of that principle. So one of the key priorities of the government is to get to a situation as quickly as possible where they can equalise the two currencies. And they promised that they would do it by the end of 2015, and they haven't been able to. Will they be able to do it by the end of 2016? They've said that they want to do it by the end of 2016. Much depends, again, on how far the government's economic performance or the economic performance of the country will go. If the process of normalisation or abnormalisation, whatever you want to call it, continues along the lines that I've said, then at least in terms of revenue and direct investment, there will be a very positive prognosis for the Cuban economy. They've said that they expect 2-3% growth this year, which is not very much, but at least it's growth. However, that may be quite a conservative estimate if the figures in terms of the growth in tourism continue. Cuba has a number of structural problems that are incredibly difficult to overcome, and the country lacks investment. It lacks enormous amounts of foreign investment, and it has to be foreign investment because the capital accumulation capacity of the country just isn't big enough for it to be able to do it itself. Now, one of the reasons why Cuba's economy apparently hasn't grown as much as it might is because the government has been very busy trying to build up its foreign reserves so that it can renegotiate its debt. And it has been successful in doing that. It's renegotiated its debt with Russia, it's renegotiated its debt with the Paris Club, it's made now a come to terms with the EU, which, you know, while it's still there, but the EU has made a commercial agreement, which means that the ways are being opened for increased investment from Europe. Although the American banks are dragging their feet, there is the intention, at least the intention and the trajectory, to enable or to take the levers off punishing foreign banks, even though they're still doing it at the moment, for dealing with American dollars. So you know, I've got a paper which is called "When is an embargo not an embargo?" When it's the American embargo of Cuba, because the embargo is still there, the blockade is still there. You know, underneath all of the rhetoric and underneath all of these talks and changes, etc., the basic fabric of the embargo is still there and it's still operating. And that's one of the reasons why the Cuban Solidarity Campaign needs to continue its work, is because it needs to keep saying, look, you know, not much has actually really changed. You've got to get rid of this embargo. You've got to push for these changes. You know, even if they're small, you've got to keep pushing for more and more changes so that the embargo comes down totally eventually. It does mean supporting I believe you need to support the process. You need to say, this is positive, Obama did the right thing, you know, we've got to push for Hillary to keep going, we've got to push for Trump to keep going if it's him. You've got to keep putting the pressure on the politicians to lift the embargo. That's got to happen. If the embargo is lifted, then the possibility for Cuba is enormous. It's absolutely enormous. Now, some people say, well, that would really be the poisoned apple because, you know, Cuba would be transformed, swamped by American money, etc., etc., and influence and so on. I think that people who think that are not really looking at it from a historical point of view. It's very, very difficult for me to see how the process that's been underway in Cuba for the last 50, 60 years, which of course was the culmination of a process that began back in the 19th century, is going to really be forgotten. There's no way the Cuban relationship with the United States is going to be one in which the United States will determine what happens in Cuba. The determination of what goes on in Cuba will be done by Cubans themselves. It won't be the United States that will dictate it. Whether the Cubans decide for themselves a path which, you know, we would disagree with, that's something else. But the process in Cuba has to be one in which the Cuban people are sovereign and determine their own self-rule. The key issue that's at play has always been, this is our house and we'll do in it what we decide, not what somebody else decides. That has been the principle, defining principle, upon which the Cuban Revolution was formed. The Castro brothers, if you want to call them that, the Cuban Revolution itself was always founded on that basic principle of sovereignty and independence, and they will not sacrifice that. That is a line that is, you know, drawn so deep that that will not be crossed. They will not give that up. Now, that's not to say that, you know, if the United States, and this is the big question, if the United States were able to truly live up to the, if not the exact words, but the sort of implied intention of the rhetoric of Obama when he visited Cuba in March, which is, you know, I have not come here to dictating you or telling you what you should do, etc., etc. That's not, the days of regime change are over, etc., etc. There isn't really anybody in Cuba that actually believes that truly, you know. You know, they kind of like, what? What? You know, that's, you know, there isn't really anybody who can actually think, well, if you think that, Mr. Obama, then, you know, there isn't a thing called American imperialism, and the Cubans know it, they've lived it. They, you know, if the Americans were able, if the United States were able to negate its, you know, being and say to the Cubans, yes, you can have exactly the kind of political system you want, the Cubans would choose socialism. Because the majority of Cubans are socialists. And that's the key. That's the key to understanding it. Which is why when, you know, there is a fear among some people that, you know, what, am I going on too long? Tell me, I'm going to stop in a minute. But I'm just digressing a little bit. But there is this situation that's developing in Latin America now where, you know, there is the pressure being placed upon the Maduro government in Venezuela. There's been this soft coup in Brazil, which is overturned. These are two key Cuban allies in Latin America, and they are two planks of the challenge to the United States' power and influence in Latin America. Both of these governments are, you know, under threat. And there is this kind of sense that, you know, Obama got nice and cozy with Cuba, and then they put the pressure on Venezuela and Brazil. And, you know, in Venezuela and Brazil, there happens to be an awful lot of Cuban doctors working. There's like 20,000 Cuban doctors up the Amazon treating poor people in the Amazon rainforest. And there's 40,000 Cuban doctors providing the National Health Service of Venezuela. And, you know, both of these governments are under pressure. And so, you know, there is this sense that, you know, what are the Cubans going to do? You know, If the Americans get really sticky with Venezuela, are the Cuban people going to be so seduced by the Americans that they're going to put pressure on their government not to help the Venezuelans out if the Venezuelan... Raul Castro was absolutely solid. He said, the Organization of American States has just moved to a motion to criticize the Maduro government. And they said, no, we stand firm with the Maduro government. We are never going to renounce our alliance with the Venezuelan people. And that absolute categorical confidence is the fact that the Cuban people are 100% behind their government. Now, there may be some discussion going on within Cuba about the pace of reform, about the nature of some of the changes. There is a debate. I'm not saying there isn't one. There is a debate. And some of the problems that have occurred in Cuba are a consequence of discussions that are taking place over what is the best strategy, the best way forward. There isn't a whole kind of total sort of agreement about some of the ways, the steps along the route, but there is absolute unanimity in defending the government's positions and the principles of socialism upon which it's founded. And that's why the Communist Party Congress passed that resolution and reaffirmed its commitment to building an alternative society to a capitalist one.
Wonderful.